Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Uncontrollable Child. Understand and manage your child's disruptive moods with dialectical behavior therapy skills. By Mattis Miller, LCSW. Foreword by Judith S. Beck, PhD. Narrated by Adam Lofbomm. Publisher's note: this audiobook refers to checklists, roadblock cards, and summaries included in the print and ebook editions of the book, as well as on newharbinger.com/46868. Foreword. As president of the Beck Institute, a nonprofit organization that provides training in cognitive behavior therapy, CBT, to mental health professionals worldwide, I'm in the enviable position of reviewing dozens of books a year in the mental health field, and quite a few about evidence-based practices for children. The Uncontrollable Child is an excellent book, one of the best, and its research-based and common-sense approach is, in my opinion, applicable to all children and their caretakers. It's written in an easily accessible, engaging style, with numerous examples of what to say and what to do. Too many books focus too narrowly on the skills parents lack. This book adds essential techniques for parents to use on themselves to change their own unhelpful beliefs and actions, to reduce their frustration, anxiety, sadness, or sense of inadequacy, so they can be more effective with their kids. Miller vividly describes why learning parenting skills alone isn't enough. Parents often need to change their unrealistic ideas and hopes for their children and move to accepting their child's struggles and difficulties. Practicing the acceptance and mindfulness strategies outlined in this book is a necessary precursor if parents wish to become effective in shaping their children's behavior. Acceptance, realistic expectations, and a calm demeanor are necessary ingredients for change, but difficult to attain without specific guidance. Miller then provides a clear roadmap for approaching children in a different way. The first step, validation, is crucially important, yet many parents, especially when they're upset, fail to use this strategy. The book offers numerous examples to illustrate precisely how to use validation in a variety of situations. Next, reinforcement strategies are described, followed by specific techniques to reduce unwanted behavior. Setting limits is another essential skill, and the book describes valuable tools for how to implement limits, and, equally important, to maintain limits over time. Finally, parents are guided in what to do when others in the family and in the child's environment resist working together to implement the recommendations in the book. I truly believe that The Uncontrollable Child, with its treasure trove of valuable skills, has the potential to help countless struggling parents and their children improve their communication, restore peace to their homes, and pave the way to an optimistic future. It has the potential to make a very significant difference in your family's life and in your own. Listen to it, try it, and watch yourself change. Judith S. Beck, PhD. President, Beck Institute for Cognitive Behavior Therapy. Clinical Professor of Psychology and Psychiatry, University of Pennsylvania. Introduction. I've met countless frustrated parents, clients, friends, lecture audiences, who express a common wish. If only this child came with a manual. Parents, even those whose children are not particularly challenging, often find themselves floundering when parenting their children. It would be so much easier, they lament, if they had clear, step-by-step instructions on how to react and respond to everyday parenting situations. The trouble isn't a lack of information. As a matter of fact, as a parent in the modern world, you have instantly available access to more parenting information than ever before. There are books, lectures, podcasts, websites. You can even get handy bite-sized tips delivered daily to your email inbox. But sometimes having all of that information can get confusing. One technique contradicts another. What worked for your first child doesn't work for the next one. You're conflicted about strategies that are so different from those that your parents used. Don't get stuck on the tricks that every parent must know or the one parenting technique that will change your life. When you listen to The Uncontrollable Child, you'll learn that you don't need to choose the right way to parent. This book may not be the be-all, end-all parenting manual, because realistically, that's impossible. But it's pretty close, and it will give you the perspective and knowledge you need to maximize all of your current skills. It will eliminate the need to find that perfect method for parenting, because it will help you make the most of every technique that you have learned and will learn. Plus, it's loaded with practical, relatable, implementable strategies that will help you along your journey. The Uncontrollable Child is based on the concepts and skills of dialectical behavioral therapy, DBT, a therapeutic model that broadens the mind and worldview. A main goal of DBT is to find your balancing point, which is unquestionably necessary on the parenting tightrope. As you listen, you will learn to balance the extremes of parenting. Acceptance with change, flexibility with consistency, limits with love. These principles form a framework you can use to improve upon your go-to parenting techniques while learning new techniques. Most importantly, you'll gain an understanding of why these techniques work and how to use them for your child and your personality. The purpose of this book. In my professional life as a therapist, as well as my personal life as a parent, I meet people who struggle in life. Many of their challenges could have been prevented or eased in childhood. The formative years are critical to the long-term well-being of every person. The relationships, habits, belief systems, and life skills that are established during childhood and adolescence are the basis of a person's future. The impact of a healthy childhood can last a lifetime, with far-reaching and long-lasting effects. The Uncontrollable Child is based on the concept that strategic, effective parenting is crucial for a child's long-term success. Parents are one of the most, if not the most, influential forces in their children's lives. When you change, your child changes. The purpose of this book is to empower parents to revolutionize their parenting and achieve their goals, to increase their child's positive behaviors, ensure that he feels loved, accepted, and understood, and decrease his non-compliant, disruptive, and aggressive behaviors. Is this book for you? DBT and the concepts outlined in The Uncontrollable Child are highly effective for children who struggle with impulse control and emotion regulation. That is, effectively managing and responding to their emotions. These children may or may not have been formally diagnosed with a disorder such as attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, ADHD, oppositional defiant disorder, ODD, or disruptive mood dysregulation disorder, DMDD. If your child has one of these disorders or symptoms, or any of them, which you'll learn about in Chapter 1, this book will help you understand and parent him or her effectively. Of course, your child doesn't need to have a diagnosis or display particularly challenging behavior to benefit from this book. While The Uncontrollable Child is geared toward parents of children with challenging behavior, it isn't only for uncontrollable children. It's a guidebook designed to help every parent reach his or her parenting potential. Climbing the Parenting Mountain. I like to compare parenting to mountain climbing. Mountain climbing requires skill, knowledge, and tools. Without tools, it's virtually impossible to reach the top. Effective climbers use tools that are designed specifically for varying terrains and applications. Some tools are effective in one situation and not another, while others may be adapted for use in various circumstances. Overusing or underusing a tool may impede the climber's progress. Using the wrong tool at the wrong time can get in the way of reaching the summit, or even cause a backslide. And of course, balance is paramount. Likewise, parenting is a journey that requires special tools. You may already have many tools in your toolbox. However, you may not be using them properly, or you may have a hard time choosing your tool. Perhaps you abandoned a useful tool out of frustration when it didn't work as promised. Or maybe you've never gotten those tools in the first place. Parenting a child who struggles with emotion regulation requires a special set of tools. Whether you're just starting the climb with a couple of tools or have acquired a set over the years, you'll benefit from a well-organized toolbox and instructions on how to use it. This book provides you with valuable, multi-terrain tools that may be adapted to nearly every situation, as well as guidance for using them properly. If you find yourself needing help to use your tools effectively, keep in mind that most expert mountain climbers are not self-taught. There's no shame in seeking out professional assistance or the advice of other seasoned parents to help you scale your mountain. If you're already working with a therapist, you can use and discuss the contents of this book alongside and in conjunction with therapy. For less formal support, try listening and reviewing it with a friend who's in the same boat. In parenting and in DBT, a healthy balance is vital. Children need a balance of acceptance, being accepted by their parents, and change, behavior modification, in order to flourish. Every person's balancing point is unique. That balancing point is rarely a straight 50-50. So it's important to find the combination that works for you and your child. The Uncontrollable Child will help you find your balance. How to use this book. This book is designed to be heard sequentially, as the foundational concepts will help you use the later skills more efficiently. As you listen and implement the skills, you'll learn what works for you. At the same time, you can always go back to review and practice earlier skills as the need arises. There are constant ups and downs in parenting, and you'll likely have to revisit different sections throughout your journey. You'll mess up at times, and that's okay. As a matter of fact, it's normal and expected. This book is here to help you bounce back when you hit a setback. It will help you navigate your own thoughts and feelings as you climb the parenting mountain. I recommend that you listen to The Uncontrollable Child in its entirety, even if you are already familiar with the concepts. You may learn new details that will help you use your existing skills more effectively. I also suggest sharing the book or discussing its contents with your spouse or other significant adults in your child's life for maximum effectiveness. For your convenience, I've created downloadable overviews that summarize the skills and concepts in each chapter. Available to you at the website for this book, http://www.newharbinger.com/46868. You can use them to guide and remind you as you listen and implement the techniques. On the website, you'll also find roadblock cards. These cards can serve as reminders of the unhelpful beliefs that can get in the way of implementing the skills in this book, as well as ways to detour around them. Additionally, the final chapter contains a comprehensive checklist, also available on the website, that recaps all of the skills. Feel free to use it whenever you need a refresher. It is my greatest hope that this book will help you climb your personal parenthood mountain, find your balancing point, and enjoy the breathtaking view from the summit. Chapter 1. Getting Started. Nobody ever said that parenting would be easy. Virtually every parent knows that children aren't just cuddly, adorable things who always do as they're told. What you may or may not have known, no matter how well prepared you were for the challenges of parenthood, was that some children are objectively harder to raise than others. Among those are the uncontrollable children, and life with them redefines the parameters of what you thought you knew about parenting. When we compare parenting to mountain climbing, these children are the rock faces and steep cliffs. If you glanced at the title of this book and thought, "Yep, that's my kid," then you know all about parenting these children. If you just picked it up out of morbid fascination and thought, "Phew, my kid isn't uncontrollable," don't stop now. Everything in here can be helpful to you too. An uncontrollable child, one who struggles to regulate her emotions appropriately, need not remain uncontrolled for the foreseeable future. with the mindset, framework, and tools that make up Dialectical Behavioral Therapy, DBT, you can once again take control of your parenting. In this chapter, you'll learn fundamental concepts that will prepare you to understand and implement the information and strategies in the rest of the book. First, we'll examine the hallmarks of uncontrollable children and the unique challenges and strengths of this particular personality trait. Next, we'll explore the basics of DBT, starting with the mystery of what exactly dialectical means and covering the foundational concepts of DBT. And finally, you'll meet a couple of children who may uncannily remind you of certain people living in your household. Who is the uncontrollable child? This child is out of control. She can't handle it when anything goes wrong. No matter what I do, he just doesn't cooperate. She refuses to listen to anything I say. I just can't get through to this kid. It's a constant battle with him. Why is she so sensitive about everything? I can't seem to do anything right with her. There is no singular definition, no clear-cut description of an uncontrollable child. He takes many forms. The drop of a hat crier, the too old for this tantrumer, the always on edge teen, the impulsive wall puncher, the exaggerated drama queen. Put simply, the uncontrollable child is one who struggles with emotion regulation. Everyone runs into challenges, disappointments, and upsetting moments in life. Most of us are able to regulate our emotions and handle these situations appropriately. Sometimes our emotions get the better of us. Uncontrollable children, those who suffer from emotion dysregulation, tend to get overwhelmed by their emotions at an above-average frequency. They overreact in ways that are not age-appropriate or socially acceptable. Bursts of anger, bouts of sadness, screaming, fighting, even self-harm. Diagnosing the uncontrollable child. Some parents have a hard time seeking a diagnosis for their child. They may prefer not to label him, believe that he'll grow out of it, be afraid of stigma, or feel like something is wrong with them if their child has an official disorder. As a mental health professional, I believe that a diagnosis, technically a cluster of symptoms, can be helpful to determine the proper course of treatment for a child or find an appropriate therapist. It gives a name to your child's symptoms for improved communication between professionals. Having a diagnosis can make it easier to modify school assignments or adapt your parenting strategies. Additionally, when people have a diagnosis for themselves or their child, it can be very validating. Their experiences and challenges suddenly make sense. I thought I was going crazy, but it turns out that this is something that actually has a name. However, depending on the circumstances, a diagnostic label may not be necessary for a child's success. A diagnosis is not an all-inclusive definition of the child, and not every part of her personality can be explained away by a diagnosis. It's not to be used as an excuse or to lead to despair. I can't do my homework all by myself, I have ADHD. Or, I'll never be able to get her under control, even the psychiatrist said that she has a real diagnosis. A diagnosis tells us what she has, not who she is. Life is challenging when you're struggling with an uncontrollable child. It's important, for your child's well-being and your own sake, to seek help when symptoms are extreme or interfere with her functioning. Let's take a look at some disorders that feature emotion dysregulation: attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, oppositional defiant disorder, and disruptive mood dysregulation disorder. Hopefully, this will help you make sense of what's going on with your child and your family. Attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. Attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, ADHD, is a fairly well-known disorder that is primarily characterized by inattention, hyperactivity, and impulsive behavior. The symptoms are present before the age of 12. In some children, they are noticeable from an early age. ADHD can be mild, moderate, or severe. Symptoms of ADHD include trouble focusing on tasks and paying attention to detail, difficulty following through and completing tasks, difficulty organizing activities or keeping track of belongings, distractibility or forgetfulness, constant motion or difficulty staying still, excessive talking and interrupting, difficulty waiting one's turn. While most healthy children are impulsive and active, the more extreme characteristics of ADHD significantly impact a child's functioning. Oppositional defiant disorder. Children who are persistently defiant, irritable, angry, argumentative, or uncooperative may be diagnosed with oppositional defiant disorder, ODD. Symptoms of ODD include defiant, non-compliant, argumentative, hostile behavior, tendency to deliberately upset or annoy others, frequent blaming of others for misbehavior, vindictiveness or spitefulness, frequent irritable and angry moods, constant loss of temper. If these symptoms are present for at least 6 months, the child may qualify for a diagnosis of ODD. Disruptive mood dysregulation disorder. A newer diagnosis called disruptive mood dysregulation disorder, DMDD, shares several hallmarks with other emotion regulation disorders, but has unique features. Due to its fairly recent addition to the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual of Mental Disorders, 5th edition, DSM-5, American Psychiatric Association 2013, a psychological dictionary of sorts, support for parents of children with DMDD is still developing. DMDD is diagnosed in children between ages 6 and 18 and is characterized by frequent, recurrent anger outbursts or explosive rages 3 or more times per week, outbursts that are not developmentally appropriate or are out of proportion to the situation, chronic, severe, unexplained irritability displayed most of the day, nearly every day, in different settings, lasting for a year or longer, symptoms that appear before age 10, symptoms that are present in at least 2 settings, home, school, and/or with peers. Prior to 2013, children who displayed these symptoms were often diagnosed with childhood bipolar disorder, which is characterized by severe outbursts and rapidly changing moods. However, when these children were monitored into adulthood, researchers found that their symptoms did not develop into bipolar disorder, meaning they did not have manic episodes or periods of mania and depression. Most went on to experience depression and anxiety as adults, prompting researchers to differentiate DMDD as a new disorder. National Institute of Mental Health, 2016. Because of their heightened emotional sensitivity, children with DMDD are more reactive to negative events and emotions. Their anger outbursts last longer than typical temper tantrums and often reflect a steady level of emotional distress, not just anger, throughout the episode. The characteristics of DMDD closely resemble those of a disorder diagnosed in adults called borderline personality disorder. Emotional dysregulation, intense anger, interpersonal chaos, anxiety, black and white thinking, and impulsivity. Because of the similarities between these disorders, DBT, which was originally developed to treat borderline personality disorder, has been found to be particularly effective for children with DMDD. In my professional opinion, DBT is the best course of therapy for these children. If you are searching for insight into your child's behaviors, you may find a lack of appropriate parenting and therapeutic resources. This is especially likely if your child has a less common diagnosis or no diagnosis at all. That's why I've written this book, to make DBT accessible to the parents of all uncontrollable children. The typical course of treatment for a child with DMDD includes parent training, individual and/or family therapy, and medication in some cases. The goal of DMDD treatment is to teach children to recognize and regulate their emotions, tolerate distress, and develop effective interpersonal skills, all of which are key features of DBT. Life with an uncontrollable child. Parenting an uncontrollable child can be exhausting, frustrating, chaotic, embarrassing, painful, and frightening. It's pretty tough on the kid, too. It can also come with a heaping dose of guilt. What did I do wrong that my child turned out like this? Even the most experienced, knowledgeable, patient, loving parents can find themselves with an uncontrollable child. A child who is emotionally sensitive, easily dysregulated, overly moody, or highly irritable. Emotion dysregulation is often misunderstood, especially by outsiders. He just needs firm discipline. All she needs is some love. Why can't you get your kid to pull himself together? You must be coddling her. You shouldn't stand for this behavior. There's often nothing that the parents could have done to prevent the uncontrollability. Most of these children are hardwired to be extra sensitive, impulsive, or otherwise uncontrollable. The good news is that there's plenty you can do now to get your life and your child's life under control. As a parent, you have the power to influence your children's lives and enable them to achieve the healthiest state possible. Childhood is the time to accept your child, build him up, protect him, defend him, and love him unconditionally, while simultaneously setting healthy limits, encouraging independence, and teaching him personal responsibility. It's time to teach him how to deal with emotional struggles on his own, and also time to teach him how to reach out for help. The parent training component of treatment for children with emotion dysregulation is an essential element. Time after time, I've seen that it's far more effective to encourage parents to change than to encourage children to change. That's because adults generally have a broader worldview than their naturally self-centered children. They're also typically more motivated, more willing to cooperate, and more capable of self-driven change than children are. This book is not about changing your child. It's about changing your parenting. As you listen, you'll learn that changing your parenting is, in fact, a key to behavior change in your children. Effective parenting is crucial for a child's emotional health, and this book will empower you to parent your out-of-control child confidently and appropriately. The basics of DBT. Before we get to the skills and strategies in this book, we'll cover the key terms and principles of DBT. Knowing these concepts will help you get into the right frame of mind to learn. It will change the way you think, talk, and act in general, which will affect the way you think, talk, and act with your children. DBT is a subset of cognitive behavioral therapy, a structured, goal-oriented, evidence-based psychotherapy that addresses cognition, emotion, and behavior. It was developed in the 1980s by psychologist Marcia M. Linehan. While DBT was originally created to help people with borderline personality disorder, who struggle with emotional and behavioral dysregulation, Linehan 1993, it has since evolved. Today, DBT is considered one of the leading methods for treating people with various mood and psychological disorders, and its concepts are useful even for those who do not have any diagnosis. Everyone, especially parents, can benefit from the skills, which help one form healthy, stable relationships and a strong sense of self. What does dialectical mean? As you may have guessed, the very essence of DBT is the concept of dialectics, which is woven into the skills and principles that you will learn. Don't be scared off by the word. It's not as scientific as it sounds. The word dialectical, which shares a root with dialogue, is defined as the ability to create a synthesis, a fusion, of two ideas that are, or appear to be, opposite or contradictory. In simpler terms, it's the art of finding the middle ground through dialogue and discussion. Many experts focus on parenting with love and acceptance, or on implementing behavioral change and disciplinary strategies. These two approaches may seem to be contradictory on the surface, and parents tend to choose one over the other at various points of the parenting journey. They may focus on acceptance. Unconditional acceptance will result in a beloved, emotionally healthy child, and I don't want her to think that I'm unhappy with the way she is. Or they may focus on change. He needs to learn how to behave appropriately, and all the acceptance and love in the world won't change him. However, both acceptance and change are necessary for raising healthy, well-behaved, balanced children. An extreme focus on acceptance generally doesn't result in improved behavior. Children won't pick up appropriate behavior on their own. Similarly, focusing only on change, especially for emotionally sensitive children, typically leads to children feeling misunderstood, defensive, and distressed. With DBT-based parenting, we recognize the value of both acceptance and change. In this book, you'll learn how to seamlessly implement them at the same time. I accept and applaud my child for who she is and what she has accomplished, and I want her to change her current behaviors. Try picking up an item with one finger. It's a whole lot easier to pick it up with two, isn't it? You need two fingers, putting pressure on the object from opposite directions to get a firm grip. That's the foundation of dialectics. Two fingers are better than one. While two concepts are, or seem to be, contradictory, you can use dialectics to fuse them together and create a stronger, firmer, more effective approach to parenting. Why dialectics? Acting and thinking dialectically helps us get unstuck from unhealthy thoughts, from ineffective strategies, from power struggles. With dialectics, there's no right or wrong method, no black and white thinking, no my way versus your way. Instead, we focus on finding that golden middle path. The benefits of dialectics are varied. When you start thinking dialectically, you can expand your thoughts and points of view to include and understand those of your children. Gain understanding and wisdom into your children's motivation and mindset. Learn to unstick standoffs. Resolve conflict with your children and reduce power struggles. Decrease isolation, tension, and polarities within yourself and your family. Become more flexible and approachable for a communicative, close-knit parent-child relationship. Avoid assumptions and blame, which in turn reduces friction and strengthens your bonds with your children. Learn to balance extremes for effective communication and problem solving. Fundamental DBT concepts. Marsha Linehan, 1993, defined three key DBT principles, which are the foundation of this book. They'll help you start thinking dialectically, enabling you to maximize every strategy. If you find these concepts a bit overwhelming, don't worry. You don't have to master them before listening to the rest of the book. This is just a preview to introduce you to the principles and language of DBT. You'll notice these themes running through each chapter, where you'll learn them in clear, applicable ways. You can always refer back to this chapter as needed. Concept number one, the world is filled with opposing forces. Because the very basis of dialectics is the act of reconciling two opposing ideas, this core concept is vital. The world is a place of opposites. There's matter and antimatter, backward and forward, black and white. And opposites can be true at the same time. You can accept your situation and work to change it. You can be tough and gentle. You can be doing the best you can and need to try harder. With that in mind, recognize that every side has truth, validity, and legitimacy. There is no singular, undisputed, absolute truth in the physical realm. Our goal is to find the sweet spot, the meeting place, the fusion of two opposing points of view. Dialectic isn't a fancy word for compromise. Rather, it's the act of recognizing and acknowledging the truth of the other side. It's easy to recognize the truth of your own opinion. The hard part is finding the truth in other standpoints and identifying the truth that is missing from yours. You achieve dialectical balance when you bring all truths together to create a more complete truth. To get started down the path of thinking and acting dialectically, try incorporating some of these tips and strategies into your daily interactions. Practice looking at all sides and points of view in various situations. Ask yourself, What am I missing here? What's the kernel of truth in their viewpoint? It may feel like playing devil's advocate. Honor and validate the truth on both sides. You'll learn all about this in Chapter 5. This does not mean that you're giving up on your values, selling out, or compromising. If you're having a hard time reconciling opposing truths, that's okay. It takes time and practice to train yourself to think differently. Embrace the paradox and become comfortable with it. Because the world is filled with opposites. Don't focus on right or wrong, good or bad. There is virtually no parenting strategy, short of abusive or neglectful behavior, that is always the right or wrong way. Instead, focus on being effective and doing what works. We'll cover this in chapters 3 and 4. Recognize that there's always more than one way to look at a problem. Imagine a giant number written on the ground. From one viewpoint, it's a 6. From the opposite viewpoint, it's a 9. People standing on either side can accurately insist that their viewpoint is the correct one. Try to see that other side, no matter how clear the right answer seems to you. Adjust your vocabulary. Switch from but to and. As you'll learn in Chapter 5, the word but cancels out the first part of any sentence. He's a great kid, but he can't control himself. She's so smart, but she doesn't apply herself to her schoolwork. Try using and in those sentences instead of but, and you'll see the difference. Skip shoulds. We'll get into this in depth in chapters 2 and 4. The word should leads to blaming and assumptions. She should know better than that. He should not be acting this way. Instead of dwelling on the way things should be, focus on the way they are and the way they can be. Move away from extremes. DBT is most helpful for people who tend to think in extremes, like your black and white, uncontrollable child probably does. Too much or too little of anything can be detrimental. Words like always or never are considered extremes, so avoid them whenever possible. Try using sometimes or often instead. However, don't be extreme in avoiding extremes. Sometimes an extreme stance is necessary to help you move away from the other extreme and land in the middle. Concept number 2. Change is the only constant. The basic dialectical balance that we strive to achieve in DBT is that of acceptance and change. While positive change may seem impossible at times, especially to parents of challenging children, it's important to remember that the world is constantly changing. In fact, change itself is the only constant in life. Can you stand in the Mississippi River twice? Sure you can, but it will be different, even if you stand in exactly the same spot, because the river is constantly flowing, shifting, changing. Whether you're stuck in a moment or a mindset, remember, change is continual, ongoing, and inevitable. We're all older than we were yesterday. You're not the same person you were a moment ago. Our children change too, and not just physically. They and we change through experience and learning. Even if it may seem that your middle schooler is still struggling with the same behavioral issues she's faced since kindergarten, she's different now than she was then. Thus, the rules and the strategies you'll use to parent her will change accordingly. This concept can be comforting when your child is going through a particularly difficult, annoying, or nerve-wracking stage. She's gone through all sorts of stages in the past that seemed interminable at the time and are now a distant memory. You may even look back fondly at those times. Ask yourself, at age 30, will my child likely still be afraid of the boogeyman, refuse to eat anything but macaroni, freak out in a thunderstorm, or think that potty jokes are the height of hilarity? The answer is probably, hopefully, no, thanks to the constancy of change. That doesn't mean that you cannot or should not try to address the issue at hand. But remember that it will probably not last forever. Just as people change, meaning and truth evolve over time as well. Those truths that you may have come to terms with can change with the passing of every moment. Even when we wish they were different, there are times when we need to accept the inevitability of change. You'll learn how to do that in Chapter 3. When we adopt the perspective that change is constant, it helps us to go with the flow and approach life with flexibility. We develop a comfortable relationship with change so that we can tolerate new challenges and obstacles. It builds resilience to the inevitable unpleasantries of life. You can incorporate this concept into your everyday life with these strategies. Embrace change as it happens. Allow change to happen while acknowledging that it can be hard. As you'll learn in later chapters, embracing the change doesn't mean that you approve, that you want it to happen, or that you are giving up your goals or values. Practice fully accepting change, even, especially, when you don't want to. You'll learn how to do this in Chapter 3. To build up to that point, start small. Take a different route to work. Sit in a different seat. Eat something new for breakfast. Don't fight the change that comes with your child's growth. You don't have to like the fact that your child has become a surly teen overnight. Remember, it will pass. Embrace it and roll with it in the present, instead of lamenting the loss of your adoring and adorable toddler. Concept number 3. Change is transactional. The third core concept of this book is that change generates change. Every person has different qualities and a unique point of view. At the same time, we're all connected. This connection means that we influence one another in all of our encounters or transactions, whether intentionally or not. This is an important truth in all interpersonal relationships, and especially in parenting. A harsh, critical person is likely to receive the same treatment in return. A kind, respectful person will usually see her behavior reflected back from others. You reap what you sow. Along those lines, when you change, others around you will change in response. You can't change other people, but you can change yourself and influence the environment and the people around you. That's the purpose of this book: to help parents change themselves and their parenting in order to influence their children's behavior. By changing how you think, feel, and act toward your child, you can affect your child's thoughts, feelings, and actions toward you. You've probably noticed this phenomenon in your other relationships. An extreme stance can push another person to the opposite extreme, commonly seen as pushback. State an opinion, and you're virtually guaranteed to find someone who responds with the opposite view. Taking many vacations from your children is essential. Leads to the response, "You should never leave your children. They can't feel like anything is more important than them." To help you put this third concept into practice, keep the following pointers in mind. You'll come across them in various ways throughout the book. Pay attention to your effect on others as well as how others affect you. Being able to recognize those effects can help you get to the root of issues and facilitate problem solving. When you observe your child's reactions to your current parenting techniques and interactions, you'll learn what's effective and what's not. Look for causes. Everything has a cause, which may be environmental, physical, situational, interpersonal, hormonal, or emotional. And finding that cause will help you determine the most effective course of action. It can be a huge relief to recognize that there is something causing your child's behavior, especially when the behavior doesn't seem to make sense. Finding the cause can make sense of the nonsensical. And even if you can't find a cause, it can be comforting to know that there is a cause. Practice letting go of blame. We'll get to that in chapters 3 and 4. It's easy to blame or judge, but this will stand in the way of effective parenting. Have you seen these children? If you have an uncontrollable child, you may recognize one or both of these children. Meet Lily. She's a creative, intelligent, 7-year-old social butterfly, the second of 3 children. She's well-loved by her many friends, a natural leader who's constantly surrounded by other kids. Her teachers say that she's an angel at school and genuinely praise her excellent grades, in-class conduct, and above-average social aptitude. Their only concern is that she gets quiet, withdrawn, and even tearful from time to time, and they're not sure what causes it. At times, she can seem to be shy, which seems to be incompatible with her personality. They're not overly worried because she's performing beautifully overall. Her parents leave teacher-parent conferences wondering if they're talking about the same child. At home, Lily is a re-embodiment of Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.